Let me share my screen. You should be able to see my screen now. So, hello.
Yes, my name is.
Okay, you can see it. Okay, so my name is Melchior Almans. I work with Juniper Networks as a consulting engineer. And today I would like to discuss the topic of the TCP authentication option, which I believe it is now time to replace MD5 with TCP/AO. And we'll go into why that is. So first of all, why would we need TCP security? Lots of operators are using MD5 to authenticate BGP sessions on Intel exchanges, for example. And one of the reasons to do that is that we try to protect these BGP sessions that rely on TCP sessions against blind insertion attacks and replay attacks. So basically what we're doing is we're trying to protect long-lived TCP sessions. And as I mentioned, BGP obviously is a very known use case, but there's other TCP-based protocols that could use authentication as well. For example, LDP, but you could also think about RPKI, RTR, of course. So basically any TCP session between two applications. So to recap, what was a blind insertion attack again? Let's say there's two routers who have a peering session on an Intel exchange. Normally those are considered long-lived TCP sessions, right? You want to set up that session, and as long as nothing breaks in between, then the TCP session, and so the BGP session is maintained. And so over time, they exchange many routes. Now, let's say at one point, a node C enters the Intel exchange and, for example, by accident configures a wrong IP address, or it tries to interfere. That could also be, let's say, a malicious attack tries to interfere with the BGP session between routers A and B. So how does such an attack look like? Router C starts sending packets to router B and uses a source address of router A. So again, that could be just a configuration accident, but it could be on purpose as well. He's sending TCP packets, and in the TCP header, he has the reset bit set. He sends those packets to TCP port 179, which is obviously a BGP port, and there's obviously a TCP sequence number. For a very long time, nothing will happen, right? Because as long as the sequence number doesn't match the sequence number that C expects, the packets will be dropped. But at one point, if router C sends a packet to router B with the correct sequence number, the BGP session, or first the TCP session, and because of that, the BGP session will reset. So that is mainly one of the reasons why we're using MD5 to protect TCP sessions, except from hijacking the BGP session itself. So obviously there's MD5 to do that, right? Probably everyone knows how to configure a pre-shared password using MD5 on a BGP session. So let's see quickly how MD5 works. Basically, these routers A and B, they agree on a pre-shared key that could either be shared using email in lots of cases, but could be snail mail or any other mechanism. So then how it works, router A, our sending router, calculates a so-called message authentication code, or in short, MAC, for each TCP segment it's sending to router B. And it uses the MD5 algorithm to calculate that MAC over the segment using the pre-shared key. It also states in the TCP header that it's using the MD5 signature option for that segment. And it includes the message authentication key. Now on the receiving side, let's say our router B also calculates a MAC for the packet it's expecting or it's receiving. So again, it uses this pre-shared key, uses MD5 algorithm to calculate that MAC, and if the MAC that it has calculated matches with the MAC that is being sent with the TCP segment, everything is perfect. If it doesn't match, then it'll simply discard the packet and no harm done. However, there are some issues, as we probably all know by now, and MD5 is deprecated. That is basically because the MD5 algorithm is at one point considered not safe enough anymore. You could factor the key. And the issue with MD5 is that you cannot roll over the key in a hitless manner. So whenever someone leaves, or you want to change the key because the database or the Excel file where you keep the keys was exposed, then you need to bring the BGP session down if you change the key. So that is an issue, right? I know in practice, these keys don't change that often, but obviously it would be nice to have a mechanism built in that would allow for hitless key rollover. And as I mentioned, TCP MD5 only supports MD5 algorithm. So those are basically the two main drivers why at one point someone started to think about how we could do this better. So a small timeline, that point I just mentioned, that was basically 2006 when Ron Bonica presented at NANOC a method, an authentication method for TCP-based routing and management protocols. It took him another 4 years together with his co-authors to write and publish an RFC, which is now RFC 5925. And then it went completely silent. Not completely. There was some work being done. Some vendors implemented a sort of pre-RFC version of TCP/AO. And in 2018, Ignaz, again at NANOC, presented a lightning talk, BGP Transport Security, Do We Even Care? Again, a couple of years later, I had the honor to present also at NANOC, that finally there were implementations of TCP/AO, and so it became time to replace MD5. The vendors currently who have implemented TCP/AO are Cisco, Nokia, and Juniper, but we'll get to implementation status later on. So then we had TCP authentication option. RFC was there, a couple of vendors implemented it, and then what? As I mentioned, the key motivations for TCP/AO were the option to have pre-shared keys and key rollover without resetting the TCP session, and support for multiple and newer authentication algorithms. So the concept of TCP/AO is very much the same as MD5. So also in this case, you configure on both sides one or multiple so-called master key tuples. And a master key tuple is basically your pre-shared key. You use those to derive the traffic keys. And then the traffic keys are used to generate the MAC use the MAC for each TCP segment. The way to calculate that MAC is in the TCP header, you include the MAC, the key ID, because obviously TCP AO allows for key rollover. You need to signal the other side which key you've been using, and the sender can, the receiver can notify in the answer the, sorry. So the TCP header contains the MAC, the key ID, and the received next key ID, which the sender sends to the receiver to indicate which key he expects the sender to use for the packet he's sending back. So the key ID identifies which master key tuple to use, Based on that, you can derive the traffic keys to generate the MAC. And again, the received next key ID is used by the sender so that the receiver knows that when he's starting to send packets back, which key to use, or at least which key the sender, in this case, router A, expects. So how does that look like, the master key tuple? As I mentioned, the pre-shared key, but also the TCP connection identifier, which is built out of the source address, destination address, and source and destination TCP ports. The RFC also allows for wildcards. So implementers could choose other connection identifiers as well. Obviously, you have to set the TCP option flag so that the receiver knows that in this case, TCP option, TCP AO is used to authenticate the packet. Again, identifiers, so key ID for outbound segments and also for the receiver, so it knows which key ID to use for inbound segments. We pick an authentication algorithm, as I mentioned, TCP MD5 obviously only allows for MD5, but TCP AO allows for multiple algorithms, so you need to specify which algorithm to use. The master key, as I said, the pre-shared key and the key derivation algorithm. So if you then look at the TCP header, basically this is how the header looks like. So you set option 29, which is registered with IANA. So you know that if you receive a packet with option 29 set in the header, that it's authenticated using a TCP AO. You specify the length of the packet, you specify the key ID and the received next key ID. And the reason for the MAC being a variable length is that it allows for multiple or newer authentication algorithms, right? Because in MD5, I believe it's not a variable length, so you're bound to MD5. So if you look at then how does it all work, if you pull it all together, each node configures one or multiple MKTs. Obviously, you can still configure a single key, but then you cannot do a key rollover. The way to distribute that key is out of scope for RFC 5925, but that could be, but that's maybe for a different presentation. And that is where you could use a quantum key distribution, for example, if you are looking for a quantum safe method to distribute keys. So each node derives four traffic keys from the configured master key tuple. On each node, you configure which master key tuple is active. Obviously, you would need to sync that. So a majority of implementations or the current implementations, Cisco, Juniper and Nokia have use a certain start time for an MKT. You could think about other methods, for example, a fixed time interval could be an option, but the implementers choose to use a specific start time. As I mentioned, you calculate the message authentication code for each segment. You choose a authentication algorithm. You calculate the MAC over that segment with one of the active traffic keys, and you include the TCP AO option in each segment. Again, the receiving node basically does the same. So it calculates the MAC for the segment it's receiving. It uses the algorithm of choose and the chosen traffic key, which is obviously should match with what we've set in the TCP header. And again, if the packet or if the MAC doesn't match, you simply discard the packet. So in that perspective, it's very similar as how MD5 works. As I mentioned, implementation status, there are currently three vendors that have implemented the code. So this is a production code that is Nokia, Cisco, and Juniper. Together with Greg Hankins from Nokia, we did some IO testing. Also, our engineers and engineers from Nokia were involved in that. We'll get to that in the next slide. And I also reached out to Huawei and Arista, but they could not give a real update, much more concrete than what is stated here. If you're interested in the work we did to test this, we started the GitHub page, github.com/tcpao, where you can find some of the configuration examples and some of the testing. And also, I spoke with Ron Bonica and Greg Hankins during one of the routing table episodes, and we asked them why are you now finally doing the TCPIO code, and why hasn't it become available earlier? A question I get a lot is, why not GTSM? GTSM is a mechanism that discards or where the sender sets the TTL of the TCP packet to 255. And so basically it can only travel to the first hop available, or the first hop. This works really well in internet exchange environments where obviously everyone is directly connected, but this won't help you to authenticate BGP sessions, for example, multi-hop BGP sessions. And it also doesn't help you to protect from IBGP sessions, right? Because in many cases, IBGP sessions obviously are multi-hop, because they travel over your layer three devices in your network. So I'm not saying you should not do GTSM. GTSM definitely has a purpose, but I really believe that security involves multiple layers. So you really want to implement GTSM and TCPIO. Back to IOP testing. I mentioned Juniper and Nokia tested. That was during Corona time, so we were not allowed to travel. It was really hard to get physical equipment in the same place. So we figured at one point, why not just use virtual devices, because both Nokia and Juniper have virtual appliances available that include the TCPIO code. So we simply tested over internet, which worked really well. So we tested multiple authentication algorithms, as you can see. We tested with a multi-hop IPv4 and IPv6 BGP sessions. And some of the lessons learned was that obviously you need to twist at one side the send ID and receive ID keys, right? That if you recall what we were just talking about, if you would configure on both sides the same send ID and receive ID for the MKTs, then obviously both expect something different. So it took some time to figure that out. And the other interesting thing was that when we started testing, the Juniper virtual device was behind the firewall. So we had no idea why the BGP session wouldn't come up. We involved engineers from both sides, and we actually figured out then that TCPIO was working as designed, and that the session did not came up because the firewall changed the TCP MSS option. So this works, is available. Obviously, there's always next steps. One of the next steps is that we're there. As I mentioned, three vendors have done the code. So we're really looking for operators to start using and testing this to get a field experience. The code is available for quite some time already. For example, in the case of my employer, it is available in 20.3R1. So that is code that is available since last year. But there's also other work to do, right? We need the rest of the ecosystem is still missing. So we need a Linux and BSD implementation so that the open source BGP developers can come on board as well. Because the kernel code for Linux and BSD needs to be done first. I submitted together with Max Tucci and couple of others, a proposal for the Riot Community Fund to get a grant to have a kernel developer work on that, but we haven't heard back yet. So I'm really hoping we'll get that because I think that would really help drive adoption. But also there's need for tools. So there's need for support in TCP dump, Wireshark, etc. And once the kernel code is ready, obviously the BERT, FRR implementers, etc. have some work to do as well. If you're interested, both Juniper and Nokia can provide you with tools to start testing. As I mentioned, the virtual devices you can use to start testing. And that is it from my side. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Melchior. We will continue with questions for you. A continuación, daremos un espacio para las
We will now have a Q&A. We encourage you to write your questions in the Q&A panel. While we wait a couple of seconds, I'd like to thank the more than 80 participants who are connected to this presentation. Now, yes, do we have any questions for Melchior?
Interesting presentation. There is one question from Douglas Fisher. Oka, the code of TCP/IO is a simple and easy implementation. I must agree with that. But why not IPsync only the BGP session? Bracket CP179 bracket between the two slides?
Yeah, excellent question, Douglas. So the reason for not, let me rephrase. The reason why we haven't seen BGP-SEC widely implemented yet is because it burdens control plane, right? In small scale, yes, you can definitely do BGP-SEC to secure your BGP sessions. However, if you want to scale this to the internet, there isn't a router's control plane that would scale to that, because obviously the control plane would need to do all the security for BGP-SEC, or terminate basically all the BGP-SEC sessions. As I said,
it doesn't scale. For that perspective, authenticating the session is much more lightweight on control plane. So that would definitely scale much further. So that is the reason for not seeing a BGP-SEC deployed yet.
Muchas gracias, Melchior. Bien, vamos a ver si es que tenemos alguna otra pregunta más de los participantes.
Thank you, Melchior. Let's see if we have more questions.
From Douglas. He said, actually, I am not talking about the BGP-SEC, just SEC of the specific traffic. BGP-SEC, say.
Okay, so. Build IPsec tunnels between nodes and run BGP session over that. Basically, because of the same reason, IPsec is much more heavier on control plane than that a simple TCP authentication would be. If in a small setup, that would definitely work. You could probably scale it to a couple of hundred, maybe a couple of thousand IPsec tunnels. But I also think that maintaining all these tunnels is quite some work. And again, you would run into resource scaling issues of control planes. So that's probably the reason. But great thinking. Thanks for the question, Sir Douglas.